Regardless of that, we almost we finished the preparation before the Salah. We talked about the wudu, we talked about the tayammum, we talked about ghusl last time, we talked about masih al-khuffayn, the wearing of the socks, or the leather socks and socks, and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and almost like the main important things regarding the preparation for Salah. And we're going to start, inshallah, tonight with other things a little bit before the Salah, and then talking about the Salah, and as long as we reach there, inshallah, because there are something very important to be known. We said we're talking about the importance of Salah in the first lecture. Was it the Salah and why it is important? What's the reward for that? As-salah, tonight we start inshallah ta'ala with the question, ala man tajib, what is, or the salah is wajib, obligatory for who, or the categories of people that as-salah is obligatory for them. As-salah tajib ala al-muslim al-aqil al-balid, salah it is obligatory for any Muslim, male or female, say, balig, that has reached the age of puberty. Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rufi'a al-qalamu an thalatha, an-nanimi hatta yastiqil, an-mubtala hatta yadrak, wa an-sabi hatta yadrak. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, this hadith, sahih, in Huwa al-Ghareeb, that the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah ﷺ doesn't take a doesn't make accountable three people. And that is the one who is sleeping until he wakes up, the one who is sick hatta until he is cured from that sickness, and the young person until he reached the age of puberty. So here we take from this hadith that until you reach the age of puberty, the salah is not obligatory. It is, as the Prophet ﷺ said, teach your kids to pray while they are 7 years old. While they are 7 years old. That's what the Ummah Maria, and just be a little bit kind sometimes, not hitting them, but just kind of hitting, not just beating them up. That's not the hadith of the Prophet. That's not saying the Prophet actually did not beat with his hand. And anyone, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while they are 10 years old, so they understand, and if they don't pray. Because if you really teach your child, since he's young, 7 years old, when he comes 8 to 10 years old, and now he really understands the importance of salah, understands. So if he doesn't do that, that means that there's something wrong with him. But we wait for the child to be 14 years old and say, no, pray. So no, I don't want to pray. I don't know what's the importance of the prayer, especially here, Western countries or whatever. We get in fight with them, and then we go, okay, I'm over now. I'm just going to send him to the masjid and tell the sheikh. Because he's doing the same. Sheikh is just only that has the button, or just a switch, make it a pious, and then not be a pious. So it's our problem that we haven't taught our kids while they are young, if it is a problem. But if you do your part, then Allah Azza wa Jalla gives you, inshallah, success and the ability to teach them right, and gives you the success that they, inshallah, are the righteous. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our families, our kids, righteous in His right path, Allahumma ameen. So we said, for everyone that is a Muslim, male or female, that is sane and has reached the age of puberty, it becomes obligatory. So, what about the child? And somebody, those kids that are under this age, 14 years old, they say, okay, I'm going to wait until 14 years old. No, it's not obligatory upon me. As we said, the hadith of the Prophet, he said, teach your مروا أولادكم بالصلاة هم أبناء سبع سنين command them or tell them to pray while they are 7 years old وضربوهم عليهم أبناء 10 سنين وفرقوا بينهم في مجالس الحديث and they inshallah they get the reward for whatever they do under the age of 14 years old inshallah and when they become 14 years old become adults Allah Azza wa Jal He writes the reward for them and that's going to be added up they get the reward Allah Azza wa Jal He doesn't make injustice to anyone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and give the reward to them. So we say, you do that as to follow the commandments of Allah and the commandments of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you get the reward. Adud al-fara'id, as we know, the salawat are 5 salawat, and we mentioned the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the salat is the only type of worship that has become obligatory in the heaven. All the other classes of worship, Jibreel alayhi salam came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and revealed them, but on the salah, Allah azza wa jal has given it directly to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while he was in the night, the rihla of Isra and Mi'raj, the trip of Isra and Mi'raj. And you remember the story when Allah azza wa jal made for 50 salat during the whole day. And imagine if we had 50 salat, 5 and the people are complaining. What about the 50? So Allah asked because He is most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made 5 salat in one day and night, and but the reward because of His mercy is for 50 salat. It's for 50 salat. The timing for the salat. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, "Inna salat kanat ala al-mu'mina kitaban mawquta." Indeed, the salat is obligatory for the believers in proper times, specific times. And the timing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown from Jibreel alayhi salam. He came one day. He came and prayed salat at the beginning of the time. And the next day, he came and prayed the salah, the ending of the time. So, and he said, كما قال في حديث رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم حديث صحيح مسلم عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وقت الظهر إذا زالت الشمس وكان الظل رجل كطولي The time of the ظهر is when the sun passes its zenith and until it reaches the shadow of a person as himself so the same length of that person the height of a person ما لم يحضر العصر unless the salat al-asr came ووقت العصر ما لم تصفر الشمس the time for al-asr is until the sun it didn't become yellowish ووقت صلاة المغرب ما لم يغلي الشفق and the time of صلاة المغرب is until that light too light it's not at the sunset or starting from the sunset and until there is still light in the horizon ووقت صلاة العشاء إلى نصف الليل أوسط the time for صلاة العشاء is at the middle of the night ووقت صلاة الصبح من طلوع الفجر ما لم تطلع الشمس The time for صلاة الفجر is from the dawn until the sunrise فإذا طلعت الشمس فأمسك عن الصلاة فإنها تطلع بين قرنين الشيطان If the sun rises, do not pray in that time because the sun rises between the two horns of the shaytan The Prophet said the sun rises between the two horns of the shaytan I'm going to talk about that inshallah because at that time the salah is not allowed pray in the time of the sun rising. So specifically the time for Dhuhr as it came in Hadith Abdullah ibn Amr, وَقْتُ الظُّهْرِ إِذْ إِذَا زَالَتِ الشَّمْسُ وَكَانَ ظِلُّ رَجُلٍ كَطُولِ مَا لَمْ يَحْضُرِ الْعَصْرُ as you mentioned. So the time for Salat al-Dhuhr is when the sun just moves a little bit from the east to the west, a little bit from the zenith, from the middle of the sky, just from the shadow for a little bit of that, then it starts the Salatul Dhuhr until the Salatul Asr when it comes when the length of the shadow of an object is like the same as the object. Let's say, for example, a person is, his height is 1 meter and 70 centimeters. If the length of his shadow, if you can see the length of his shadow is 1 meter, 70 centimeters, plus, let's say, 5 centimeters, 175, then his time of Salatul, it's the ending of the Salatul Dhuhr and the beginning of Salatul Asr. The ending of Salatul Dhuhr and the beginning of Salatul Asr. And then the time for Salatul Asr is, it starts when the length of the shadow is like that object, the same like the object plus that part of the, when you pass the zenith a little bit. And until the preferred times, that the preferred time is until it becomes as twice as the object. As twice the object, this is the time of when the, you know, the sun is almost yellowish coming to the west. But it is allowed if somebody doesn't have time, what happened to him is allowed until Salat al-Maghrib, except that part that it is before Salat al-Maghrib, that is makruh, it is Salat makruh or disliked, unless there is a dawur, there is a necessity to pray that time, because even the person did not pray. Salat al-Asr, it is the Salat al-Wusta. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran, حَافِظُوا عَلَى الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاةِ وُسْطَى وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ. Keep maintaining the salawat, guard your salat, meaning that you always do your salat in time. وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى. And Allah has emphasized the middle prayer. What's the middle prayer? The scholars have said this middle prayer is from the hadith, actually from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It is Salat al-Asr, because it comes in the middle of Salawat. Salat al-Fajr, Salat al-Dhuhr, Asr is in the beginning, then we have Maghrib and Isha. It is very important, Salat al-Fajr. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, on the day of Khandaq, the battle of trenches, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, مَدَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ بُيُوتَهُمْ وَقُبُورَهُمْ نَارًا كَمَا شَغَلُونَ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى حَتَّى غَبَتْ الشَّمْسِ. That day, because they were fighting with the disbelievers and the mushrikeen, so they missed Salat al-Asr until the Maghrib came. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very angry for that, we're missing one Salat. What about us? If we miss one Salat, inshallah we're going to catch up with that. SubhanAllah. Yeah, how they were. People, not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but even the Sahaba, and after that, if they don't see anyone in the Masjid, not, maybe he prayed at home, for sure he prayed at home, but they don't see in the Masjid, they go and visit him home, because there is something. He doesn't come to the Masjid, he always comes to the Masjid, there is something. And if he missed one Salah, they visit him for that reason, because it's like he was sick for that. They visit because he missed one Salah. So the Prophet ﷺ, when he missed this Salah because of Mushrikeen, he said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill their houses and their graves, the Mushrikeen meaning, with fire. Like they let us made us busy from the Salat al-Asr until we, and they said Salat al-Usta, the middle Salat, that means Salat al-Asr. This is the point here in Hadith. They let us or made to miss Salat al-Asr before, until the Maghrib came. And for the Salat al-Asr, it has come a very scary Hadith if you miss Salat al-Asr, you miss it. Totally. And Abi Munayh قال كنا مع بريدة في غزوة في يوم ذي غين. We were with بريدة in a battle in a day that was cloudy. فقال بكروا بصلاة العصر. He said, pray صلاة العصر on time. فإن النبي, this is Sahabi saying, pray صلاة العصر in the beginning of the time. فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من ترك صلاة العصر فقد حبط عمله. Whoever abandons, leaves صلاة العصر, his deeds are going to be destroyed. His deeds are not going to be considered. صلاة العصر, this is صلاة الوسطى. And subhanAllah, we see why it's صلاة العصر, because we see like the least jama'ah is the صلاة العصر, because people usually are are working and things. Doesn't say, but this is very important to not leave it, or I can pray it after, I can pray it another time or things. No. Because in this hadith, another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ قَالَ أَلَّذِي تَفُوتُهُ صَلَاةُ الْعَصْرِ كَأَنَّمَا وُتِرَ أَهْلَهُ وَمَالَهُ. The one who missed Salat al-Asr, meaning here intentionally, not because it happened something, but meaning you were negligent for that Salat al-Asr. The one who misses Salat al-Asr, it is like his family and his wealth is gone. Imagine that you are, Alhamdulillah, Allah has given you money and health, Alhamdulillah, your family, your kids, and then imagine that you go home, hopefully it doesn't happen to anyone, you go home and you see that none of your family is there, all dead, and all of your money is gone, everything that you have. This is the way the Prophet is saying, if you miss Salat al-Asr, imagine yourself in that way. Not just only imagine, but it is that so severe that it is like all of our deeds are gone. Even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our families and ourselves and make us those who always pray the salat and in jama'ah. Waqtu salat al-Maghrib. Waqtu salat al-Maghrib, that it starts at the sunset, as we said. Fa'idha ghaba jami'u kulli ash-shams, when the sun, we see that it has he was gone in the west and it has been disappeared. وَيَسْتَبِرُنَا لَغِيْلِ الشَّفَقِ الْأَحْمَرِ, and it continues until the twilight of the red twilight is on the horizon. فَإِذَا صَلَّيْتُمُ الْمَغْرِبِ فَإِنَّهُ وَقْتٌ إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَسْفُطَ الشَّفَقِ, until this time. So that is almost like 1 hour or so after sunset. It is the sunnah of the Prophet to pray Salat al-Maghrib, like not to have too much time between Adhan and Iqamah, so I don't pray it faster. As one of the reasons why we know that Yawm al-Qiyamah is going to be Salat al-Maghrib. Yawm al-Jum'ah, Salat al-Maghrib, or the time of the Maghrib or sunset, that's going to be Yawm al-Qiyamah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And يقينا شروقا اللهم امين. صلاة العشاء, it starts from when the time of the red twilight is gone from the horizon until half or the middle of the night. We have many different opinions that some they say it is allowed to pray Salat al-Isha until, because the next salah is Salat al-Fajr, so you have time until Salat al-Fajr. Some they say you have time until the last third of the night. Different opinions for that, but actually there is no authentic hadith telling us that you have time for this until Salat al-Fajr or until the last third of the night. Actually, the authentic hadith of the Prophet also that we mentioned a part of it, that the time for Salat al-Isha, that's accepted time, like it's the same for the Fajr. The time for Salat al-Isha is up to the middle of the night. Up to the middle of the night. So, what time is the middle of the night? No, it's not 2 o'clock.
2 o'clock.
So, we just, how we do it, because our night in Islamic calendar starts from the Maghrib. Okay, so start from the Maghrib. From Maghrib is 5:45, and Salat al-Fajr is 6:12. Let's say 6:10. So what is it from 5:45 to 6:10 is almost 12 hours. 12 hours of time. So 6 hours from 6. Now it's 12, but usually sometimes it could be 1, sometimes it could be 2. It depends. Okay. But now it's almost 12. So you have time to pray Salat al-Isha up to 12 o'clock, you can pray by yourself, I'm saying. But after that, let's say somebody forgot. If you forget, and you said there's a time, whatever, where you slept or slept and you didn't pray Salat Isha, you have time even after, because it is the, that's the proper time. As the Prophet he said, whoever slept or he forgot and he didn't pray Salat, the time for the Salat is whenever he wakes up and whenever he's reminded. So, but usually it is up to the middle of the night. And we said how we calculate the middle of the night from the Salat Maghrib. That's the last part of Isha. But if a person lives after that, that's not considered. Like the Salat al-Fajr, for example. So the time for Salat al-Fajr is from the dawn until sunrise. Somebody can say, well, we have time until Dhuhr. There's a lot of time. No, that's not its time. Because it's the only Salat actually that is there's a long time between there and between Salat al-Fajr and Salat al-Dhuhr. But that's is if, as we said, you forgot or it happened something that you pray Salat, but the timing for Salat al-Fajr is from the dawn until the sun rises. For Salat al-Fajr, we have, that's why the Sunnah of the Prophet was how many adhans? Words, two adhan, not one adhan that you do in Salat al-Fajr. The Sunnah of the Prophet was to be calling two adhans. The first adhan was ash-shaqaq, or was the al-fajr al-kadhib, the fake fajr, dawn. And the other one, al-fajr sadiq, the real fajr. What does that mean then? The first adhan was Abdullah ibn Maktoum, like 15 minutes almost, 15 minutes before the real adhan. Or the real time. Why did it was that? Used to remind the people who were there praying Salat al-Layl, Qiyam al-Layl. So now it's almost coming the time for the Adhan. So prepare yourself for Salat al-Fajr. Or those people that they want to fast. So it's the time you can eat the Suhoor. For there, because it's going to eat the Suhoor closer to the Adhan. To the Fajr, the Salat. And then it came the time, so the time for the Fajr, and that was the second Adhan to be called. So that was the Sunnah of the Prophet to call two Adhans in Salat al-Fajr. It is Sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with of the Salat al-Fajr at the Risu bi Salat al-Fajr to be prayed. It's in the beginning of the time while it's still dark. That's the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's a hadith, another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, أَسْفِرُوا بِالْفَجْرِ فَإِنَّهُ أَعْظَمُ لِلْأَجْرِ. Another hadith that in the appearance, it seems that this is different or is conflicting with the other word of the Prophet sallallahu to pray at the beginning of the time or when it's dark. But this hadith actually has the meaning, أَسْفِرُوا meaning from coming, the time was almost to the sun rise, or so almost is enlightened, the horizon is enlightened, you can see. But here we get, because it has more ajr, has more reward. But here we get, how can we combine and we reconcile between these two hadith? We say that, as the scholars have said, you start the fajr at the beginning of the time, anyone that waits the darkness. And it is a sunnah to recite more in Salat al-Fajr, so it is a longer salat. It was a longer salat. So when Abu Bakr had a longer time, he prayed the salat, and it was almost sunrising. Almost from the Fajr till sunrise, they were reciting Quran. And when they said to him, radiallahu anhu, said, even if the sunrise was going to witness for us that we're still praying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Salat al-Fajr, so it's a sunnah to make it longer, Salat al-Fajr more longer than the other salawat, with reciting more the Quran in the, because the salat, especially Salat al-Fajr, it is mashhud, it is witnessed from the angels. is wisdom from the recitation of the Quran. Let's say a person, he came late, or he woke up late, and he has time only for one rak'ah. Does he pray or not? We say he prayed. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, مَنْ أَدْرَكَ مِنَ الصُّبْحِ رَكْعَةً قَبْلَ أَنْ تَطْلَعَ الشَّمْسُ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الصُّبْحَ وَمَنْ أَدْرَكَ رَكْعَةً مِنَ الْعَصْرِ قَبْلَ أَنْ تَطْلَعَ الشَّمْسُ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الْعَصْرَ. Whoever catches one rak'ah from Salat al-Fajr before the sun rises, he has caught his salah, so it's in time. Even if you pray the second rak'ah after the sun rises, because he caught one rak'ah in its proper time, your salah is in time, inshallah. And whoever caught one rak'ah in Salat al-Asr before Salat al-Maghrib, he has caught his salah. Here, the Prophet he gave examples, Fajr and Asr, but doesn't mean that other salawat, you don't catch it if you pray one rak'ah. Another hadith, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ أَدْرَكَ الْعَصْرَ سَجْدَةً قَبْلَ أَنْ تَقْرُبَ الشَّمْسُ. Whoever catches Salat al-Asr sajdatan, one sajda. What's the meaning of one sajda here? Explain. Sajda before the sun sets, he has caught his salah, or Salat al-Subh, Fajr, قَبْلَ أَنْ تَطْلَعَ, before the sun rises, فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَهَا, he has kept. وَالسَّجْدَةُ إِنَّمَا هِيَ رَكْعَةٌ. The sajda here means one rak'ah. Doesn't mean only one sajda, but means one rak'ah, because it came in the hadith, but not by the words of the Prophet, but the rawi, the narrator of the hadith, he has put the word in the hadith. That's called mudraja in the hadith, the signs of the hadith. That means whoever catches one sajda means one rak'ah. He has caught the salah and is considered. What are some of the times when the Prophet prohibited to pray at those times? First, بعد صلاة الفجر حتى تطلع الشمس. After صلاة الفجر, there is no sunnah until sun rises. We're going to explain some times when you can pray or something. وحين طلوعها تترتفع قد الروح. Or at the time of the sun rises until it will be raised or raised up for one spear. It's almost 15 minutes. That's what we pray Salat al-Shuruq here in the masjid. وحين استواءها, the time when it is in the middle of the sky. It's not allowed. It's zawal. وحين تميل إلى الغروب, and the time before Salat al-Maghrib, 10 minutes or 15 minutes, like the same we said for sunrise. It is the Prophet ﷺ being prohibited to pray in this time, except where I have some exceptions. وبعد صلاة العصر حتى تغرب الشمس. And said after صلاة العصر until the Maghrib comes, as we said, it is when the sun becomes yellowish before صلاة المغرب. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, لا صلاة بعد صلاة العصر حتى تغرب الشمس ولا صلاة بعد صلاة الفجر حتى تطلع الشمس. There is no salah, means it's not allowed to pray after Salat al-Asr until the sun sets, and there is no salah after Salat al-Fajr until the sun rises. So this is times where it's disliked or is not allowed to pray salah. Regarding Salat al-Fajr, we said after Salat al-Fajr you should not pray any sunnahs unless you have missed the two sunnahs that are of Fajr. Let's say if you came late in the masjid and you missed two sunnahs of Fajr before the Jama'ah, you can pray two sunnahs after Salat al-Fajr. Okay, this is an exception. But generally speaking, you should not pray any salah after Salat al-Fajr until the sun rises, and then wait for 15 minutes and you pray Shuruq or Duha. And the time we set the middle and for the Shuruq, Salat al-Shuruq, we pray in the masjid, that you should wait at 15 minutes after the sun rises and then you pray, because as we said, in this time the sun rises between in the middle of two words of the shaitan. And the mushrikeen is the time when the mushrikeen make sajda to their idols of the sun. So this is the time when it's not allowed to pray salah, but you should wait and then pray salah in shuruq or duha. And the other case, we said before maghrib, the Prophet it didn't allow, except we said if you have a fariḍah, you have to pray salah, you pray salah, that's what you have, you pray there. Or, let's say for example, there are some exceptions, you come to the masjid and you have to pray tahiyyat al-masjid. Tahiyyat al-masjid is wajib. Tahiyyat al-masjid is obligatory when you enter the masjid. This is the first time. When you come to the masjid, you should pray tahiyyat al-masjid. But this is the time, almost 10-15 minutes before maghrib, you should pray tahiyyat al-masjid here, because that's an exception. Yeah, and you know, all this time, and this time, this whatever is salat is obligatory, this is an exception, you should pray. Or you have sunnatul wudu, for example. You have made wudu, he said, is the sunnah of the Prophet. When you make, whenever you make wudu, you pray to rak'ah sunnah. The hadith of Abu Hurairah. And so, you do that, inshallah, there is no problem for that. And they get a masjid, then, or could happen some in those times, for example, it is not allowed. There is a salah that if you don't do it, you miss it. Like salat al-khusuf wal-khusuf, the eclipse salah. You know, the sunnah of the Prophet to praise the eclipse salah until the eclipse is gone. So it could happen that the eclipse be in this time, before Maghrib or at Fajr time. So if you don't pray it, you miss it. So in this time, it is allowed for you. That's a jama'ah. Is allowed to pray salah in this time, even if it is, generally speaking, it's not allowed to pray salah, but because this is an exception, you pray the salah in this time. That's for the timing of the salawat, that's when we should pray it, as the Prophet said. Between the adhan and the qamah, we're talking about the adhan and the qamah, inshallah. There is salah. Always, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, an Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, qala, idha uqimat salatu fala salata illa maktuba. Here, no, between adhan and qamah, I'm going to go back, inshallah. Here, some people I see that whatever the qamah is being done, and you hear the iqamah, some people still continue praying salat al-sunnah. That's what is being called the shaytan. He goes away. He doesn't want to listen to the adhan. What a hood, and he passes gas with a loud sound. حَتَّى لَا يَسْمَعَ التَّعْدِي. He doesn't want to listen to the adhan. فَإِذَا قُضَى النِّدَاءُ. When the adhan is finished, أَقْبَى. He comes back again. Until the iqamah is been done, he goes, and then it comes to the time of the salat and starts to mess up our salat. That's what he wants. And that's when our thoughts come in our salat, always, because the shaitan is there, or shayateen. وَعَنْهُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ النَّبِيُّ وَيَا رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَيْنَا أَنَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ قَالَ لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثم لم يجدوا الا ان يستهموا عليه لاستهموا ولو يعلمون ما في التهجير لاستبقوا اليه ولا يعلمون ما في العتمه والصبح لاتوها ولو حبوا. In this hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if people really know the importance and the great reward of the adhan and coming in the first line, first saf, then they will not find any other way just to find a spot in the first line, just to say the adhan, unless they draw lots, they would have done it there. وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ مَا فِي التَّهْجِيرِ. If they really know the importance and the reward of coming early in the salah, they will compete for coming early in the salah. And if they really know what is the great reward for the Salat al-Isha and Salat al-Fajr, لَأَتَوْهَا وَلَوْ حَبْوَا. They would come, would have come in the masjid to pray, even crawling, like a baby. Crawling in the masjid. We come with our cars, we come with walking, and just Alhamdulillah, when you come, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. But he said even crowding because of the importance of Salat al-Isha and Salat al-Fajr. وعن معاوية رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول المؤذنون أطول الناس أعناقا يوم القيامة. Those who call the adhan, muadhin, they will be the people that have the longest necks on the day of the judgment. What does it mean to have the longest neck? Does it mean that they have some kids, they try to imagine, oh, why did they would have this? Doesn't look good, the long neck and the body. But it doesn't mean that, meaning that here they will have the longest neck, they will be from, all people, they're going to look at them because they're going to be most honored. One of the most honored people there, Allah Azza wa Jalla will honor them. Those people, they call the adhan, the hidayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There, and they're going to be bright and enlightened from this adhan, they're going to call in this word of life. And another beautiful hadith for those who call the adhan, the Prophet said, and the Rasulullah said, قال, لا يسمع مدى صوت المؤذن جن ولا إنس ولا شيء إلا شيء يلوي يوم القيامة. There is nothing from the creation of Allah, jinn, insan, mankind, or jinnkind, or anything that Allah has created, that they listen to the adhan, except that they are going to witness for that on the day of the judgment. Every single thing you're going to witness for your adhan, on the day of the judgment, that this person has made the adhan. What a great honor and reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hadith an Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يغفر للمؤذن منتهى أذان ويستغفر له كل رطب ويابس سمعه. To the muaddin, you're going to be forgiven to him the distance of his adhan, and whatever his voice reaches, that's going to be the forgiveness of him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is, and every single creature, the creation of Allah that listens to his adhan, we're going to ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive him. This is the reward of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That doesn't mean that people should stay in line to call the adhan. That's good. Everyone should learn the adhan first. And if you do like that, you should make a list, a line for people to call the adhan. Inshallah, those who call it good. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he made dua for the mu'addineen, those who call the adhan, and then the a'imah, for the imams. فَقَالَ اللَّهُمَّ أَرْشِدِ الْأَئِمَّةِ. Oh Allah, guide the imams. وَاغْفِرْ لِلْمُؤَذِّنِينَ. Better for the mu'addineen. And forgive the mu'addineen, those who call the adhan. So nobody wants to be an imam, because the imam has responsibility. They want to call the adhan, after just call the adhan, and Allah, and the Prophet has asked forgiveness for him, for those who call the adhan. And there's another narration, but yeah, in this narration, قال عائشة رضي الله عنها قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الإمام ضامن والمؤذن مبتلن فأرشد الله الأئمة وعفى عن المؤذنين. Almost the same as the first, but he said الإمام ضامن. The imam is the one who guarantees. And he do something wrong, I take it, my shoulders, no, I forgive him. So here, but when you need to make dua for the imam. والمؤذن مؤتمن. The مؤذن is مؤتمن, he trusted for something. He trusted for something, for the adhan. فأرشد الله من أئمة. May Allah give guidance to the أئمة, the imams. وعفى عن المؤذنين. May Allah forgive and pardon the مؤذنين. The مؤذنين. And another hadith, he's not here, but remember now, but the Prophet said that whoever, but me, calls the adhan for 12 years, inshallah, he's one of the people of the Jannah. 12 years, who calls the adhan for 12 years, not 12 days, 12 years. So, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the story of how the adhan was and how it started. It started from a dream that the Sahabi, or the two Sahabis, they saw dream for the adhan. And that the Jews, they had, or the Christians, they had the bell, and the Jews, they had the horn. And Allah Azza wa Jalla guided them to have beautiful voice of a man to call his Adhan. And the Adhan, as we said, it is wajib to be called, and we have a hadith for that. The first hadith, Malik ibn Huwayd radiallahu anhu qala, أتينا إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ونحن شبابة متقاربون فأقمنا عنده 20 يوما وليلا. We came to the Prophet and we are young people and almost the same age. And we stayed with him صلى الله عليه وسلم 20 days and nights. Doesn't mean they stayed in his house, but they stayed in the Medina of the Prophet. وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رحيما رفيقا. He's telling how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was in teaching them. He was رحيم, very kind, رفيقا, soft and gentle. فلما ظننا أن قد اشتهينا أهلنا صلى الله عليه وسلم. When he understood that they were travelers, like 20 days they stayed here. So when he understood that, or he just hinted, or understood that we were missing our families for 20 days. أو قد اشتقنا, we're missing, yearning for our families. سألنا عمن تركنا بعدنا. He asked us, what did you leave behind? Do you have family there? فأخبرنا, we said yes. We informed him. قال ارجعوا إلى أهلكم. Go back to your family. صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأقيموا فيهم وعلموهم. Go back and stay with them and teach them what I taught you in those days. ومروهم and command them to do this and this and that. So he commanded them with things. And he said some things I remember, some I don't remember. Some things that the Prophet has mentioned. وصلوا, and then he continues saying, وصلوا كما رأيتمون يصلي, this hadith. And pray as you see me pray. So teach them and pray you and teach them how to pray as we saw me pray. فإذا حضرت الصلاة فليؤذن لكم أحدكم وليؤمكم أكبركم. Here is the point for the wujub of the adhan. He said, when the salah, the time for salah is there, so the time the salah came, let any of you to make the adhan. Let one of you make the adhan, and one of you make or be an imam for the prayer. وحديث أمر بن سلمة رضي الله عنه وفيه أن قال أي نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, صلوا صلاة كذا في حين كذا. Pray this salah in this time. صلوا كذا في حين كذا. Pray this salah, meaning the other salah, in that time. فإذا حضرت الصلاة, if the time of salah comes, فليؤذن أحدكم وليأمكم أكثركم قرآنا. And then any one of you make the adhan. So it tells that he should do the adhan. If it is not wajib, the Prophet would have not mentioned that, because just you can do it or not. But he mentioned to have to do it, the adhan, and any the one who knows or memorizes more Quran from you, let him be your imam. The adhan is, as we know, and I think everybody knows the adhan is well known, that has 15 words. That's most well known. But there is another type of the adhan that it's not well known. That has 19 words. What are the words that are added? Anybody knows?
Fajr. Time of Fajr.
No. Yeah, for the Fajr, that's different, but there's something different. But it is, when you say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, that's four. When you say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah, Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah, this you say it twice. The imam, I'm sorry, the muallim, he says it in himself. Not the people, they don't listen. They say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Then he says, so these are four words are added, but that's sometimes used to be done in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the one known is that we have 15 words, except the Salat al-Fajr, that we add a Salatu Khayru min al-Nawm. A Salatu Khayru min al-Nawm. As we said, this Sunnah, to be added those words, it was in the first Adhan, not the second Adhan. Why? Because we said the first Adhan is to remind the people to eat suhoor and to remind the people that are sleeping. So Salat al-Khayru min al-Nawm. The Salat is better than sleep. Better than sleep. So that was in the first Adhan, not the second Adhan. Like they do, for example, in Saudi Arabia, they do in the first Adhan even in Jordan, first Adhan, Salatu Khairun, and all the Salah is better than sleep. Salatu Khairun. And then you have the Iqamah. The Iqamah is made shorter than the Adhan, or another narration is the same words as the Adhan, except you have قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. So the first, have إِقَامَتْ الصَّلَاةِ وَتَقُولُ إِذَا أُقِيمَتِ الصَّلَاةِ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ حَيَّ الصَّلَاةِ حَيَّ الْفَلَاحِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. This is the well-known narration that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to teach the Sahaba, that they used to do it, or the same like the Adhan, the same words of the Adhan, just by adding قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. So that's another narration, authentic hadith narration from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is, as we said, from the great mercy of Allah azza wa jal and His justice, He doesn't let all the mu'addin to get the reward, but you can get the same reward of the mu'addin by just simply repeating the words of the mu'addin. You repeat the words of the Muaddin, alhamdulillah, you get the reward of the Muaddin. Another reward that was not mentioned here, that the Muaddin takes the reward of every person that is praying with him. So how many people, the one who calls the Adhan in Jummah, 2,000 people are praying with him, the Muaddin takes the reward of their Salah without decreasing their Salah reward. This is a great mercy and a great blessing and favor from Allah Azza wa Jal. But you can take that reward to by repeating the words of the Adhan. Repeating the words of the Adhan, and then at the end of the Adhan you say the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us to say. Who knows the dua at the end of the Adhan? Allahumma ya Rabbi hadhihi da'wati at-tama, as-salatu al-qa'imah, ahli Muhammadin al-wasilah wa al-fadilah, wa ba'athu al-maqama al-mahmudan, alladhi wa'adta. There is innaka la tukhlifu al-mi'ad. There is no narration, authentic narration for that. Yes.
You say repeat the more than whatever you say, but some people say how when they say the la or what
to repeat. To repeat, yes. Instead of ala salah al falah, you say la hawla quwwata illa billah. Yes, this is only time you don't repeat the same exact words of the muaddin, but you say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. What's the meaning of la hawla quwwata illa billah? And there is wisdom behind why you say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Beautiful meanings. Because meaning la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, it means there is no might, no power except with Allah azza wa jalla. And the muaddin is saying, hayya la salah, come to the prayer. And by Allah, if Allah azza wa jalla doesn't help you, you will never come to the prayer and you will never perform it as He wants. So that's why you say, La hawla ya Rabb, O Allah, O my Lord, there is no might, no power, there is no way that I can perform the salah as you want unless you help me. La hawla ni wa la quwwata illa billah. Don't say la hawla ni wa la quwwata illa billah. I mean, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no might, no power except with Allah Azza wa Jalla. If you really help me, I will perform as you want. Otherwise, I am a weak slave and servant of you. I cannot do anything unless you help me. The same thing, hayya al-falah, come to the success. There is no way that you can reach the success. La falah. There is no way to reach success unless Allah Azza wa Jalla has written for you to be successful. And this word line here. Unless Allah Azza wa Jalla helps you, you cannot do anything good for that unless Allah Azza wa Jalla is helped. Even if you want to read a page of a Quran or an ayah, say, I'm going to do it. Don't say inshallah, I'm going to do it. But if you really don't have to ask Allah Azza to help you, then there's no help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, because we are asking Allah to help us in this salah and to perform it as He wants to be performed, subhanahu wa ta'ala. As you said, it is to repeat the words of the Adhan is mustahab, is preferred, but it's not why. Okay? But if you don't, if you want to enter Jannah, you do it. If you don't want to, don't. If you, it's just. It's not wajib, you cannot make it wajib, but alhamdulillah, even then give the reward. Talking about the sunnah and the adhan, because people, they want to know what's the sunnah for the adhan. It is, the one who does the adhan should do it only for the sake of Allah, for anything, if the intention should be there. Only for the sake of Allah, not for people to listen to his beautiful voice, and then the proud comes in his heart, and Allah doesn't accept that, because this is, or to get money for the adhan. Now, the Prophet has said that, before the day of the judgment, people gotta get money for the adhan, gotta get money for the Quran, reciting the Quran for money, beautifying their voices for money. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And that has happened, is happening, is gonna happen, before the Day of Judgment too. It is mustahab, and it's from the adab of adhan, to have, for sure, to have wudu, when you call the adhan. That doesn't mean that you cannot call adhan while you have wudu, but the best, for sure, is to have wudu, because you have a lot of hawa, and you are calling the beautiful words of the adhan, calling people to the tawheed of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
In our country, it happened like, you know, certain occasion they call the Hafiz to finish the Quran, means khatam, and the homeowner gives the money. So, how is considered as if the seller selling Quran khatam, something like Hafiz? And it's happened frequently.
As we said, the Prophet said, the Quran should not be recited for money. And I know, not only your culture, every Arab country too.
They don't ask for the certain amount, but they just give more case.
Oh, that's better. They don't ask. But nowadays, it became an integration. Raka, $1,000. In Tarawih only, not outside. Because Surah al-Fatiha, $500. That's worse. That's, first of all, that you should not go. If it does it, for Tarawih is something else, and even if they give it, just give it for the sake of Allah, and don't ask. They should not ask anything. But if they, for what is the occasion they recite for when they finish the Quran?
Like,
somebody dies.
Oh, there is other case. Somebody dies in the Quran, then there's another story. وما بني على غير مشروط أو غير مشروط. Whoever is built, if the building is bad, the whole building is going to collapse. I mean, the occasion should not be like that. So taking money is something, we don't discuss it. So if it's not allowed to do, first of all, to do that because somebody died, to go recite the Quran.
Like, especially in the every year, like the certain day, like whatever the day they died, then normally the culture, they do it, they call the Hafiz.
Yeah, but that's not from the Sunnah of the Prophet.
Maybe Christmas?
No.
No pressure. That's not from the Sunnah of the Prophet, to be exact. So, if it's not, for sure, giving money is not, it's more, it's adding some, adding fuel to the fire. If you can understand that. So it's not, it should not be done like that, taking money for those occasions. The Sunnah of the Prophet means to the adhan to be called while standing up. That's the Sunnah of the Prophet while we're standing but not sitting down. To be facing the Qibla. And the Sunnah of the Prophet to call the adhan is to put the index fingers inside of the ear, or to close the ears, or like this.
Some people doesn't follow that.
Some people doesn't follow that. We have a lot of other things too. People they don't follow. We're just explaining what is the way the Prophet did it, or he taught the Sahaba to do it. So this is the Sunnah. Meaning, it's not like the Sunnah. That's the way the Prophet taught the Sahaba to do. So put the index fingers inside, like this. Like when you may wipe the ears when wudu, or mathematical machine. or like this.
So,
no, this is yes, because I have seen some brothers when they call the Iqamah, they do the same. This is for the Adhan only. For the Iqamah, no. Yes. Sorry? I don't know any hadith that he called that. No. As far as I know, I don't remember any hadith that he called that. And you stopped the Qibla, yeah. And you said one, the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ for the Muaddin, one he says, Hayya al-Salah, Hayya al-Falah, he has to turn only the face towards the right and towards the left, not the body. That was the way or some people, when they call the Adhan, because they don't know, we don't make it, and we want to teach them. So the Prophet ﷺ used to teach the Sahaba, as you said, because he didn't call the Adhan, as far as we know. And only turn the face. Hayya ala salah. Only the face, not the whole body. Like this. Or like this, so that people say, we do it. So, Hayya ala salah. Hayya ala salah. Hayya ala falah. Hayya ala falah. Okay, so only your face. That was the only time. To turn the face towards the right or the left. But the chest and the body, no. Is the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to raise the voice? When you don't have a microphone, but even if you have a microphone, just come close to the microphone, because it doesn't bat away the voice too much. But if you don't have a microphone, you raise your voice to be heard, because as we said, every single thing will be witnessed for you on the day of the judgment. The adhan should not be prolonged too much. We have nowadays many types of the adhan that they are like singing songs. A lot of, like, even the adhan, it should be like, the ahkam of tajweed, the rulings of tajweed, the same should be adapted to the adhan. So if we have a man stretching no more than six, that's the 6, no 15, or making a longer prolongation, Allah, and other things, and it becomes, it seems beautiful to you, but that's not the adhan that should be done. And to prolong that is not considered from the Sunnah, but saying like simple adhan, the wording of this adhan, just call, and it is a Sunnah that the one who calls the adhan should, and it is better to have a beautiful voice. Because we know sometimes some brothers, they have alhamdulillah, they have that enthusiasm or the desire to call their name, that's good. But they don't have that, maybe that beautiful voice. Sometimes maybe some people could be scared of the voice. And you with the beautiful adhan, you can, and has happened that people have become Muslims. Just by the words of the adhan, like listening and have become Muslims. Like subhanAllah, it has these words, especially when the beautiful voice comes with it, it has that impact in the heart. Is that the Quran too? The same thing. That's why the Prophet said, Zayyinul Quran bi aswatikum. Purify the Quran, recite the Quran with your voices. Beautify the Quran with your voice and having a beautiful voice. And a beautiful voice comes from Allah as a gift from Allah Azza wa Jal. So beautify it, but not to make it like a song. But feel it, and when you feel it, you will make people feel it. Because you really will feel it, and then Allah Azza wa Jal gives you that success, and gives you that barakah, the blessing, that people will feel it, because you will make them feel that Quran or that Adhan that you are doing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Waiting time between the adhan and the iqamah. Well, we said that there is always between the adhan and the iqamah, sunnah, the Prophet, there is 2 rak'ah sunnah. It is a sunnah to pray between the adhan and the iqamah, every salah. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bayna kulli adhanayni salatun, thalatha liman shaa. He said, between 2 adhans, meaning 1 adhan and iqamah. That's what it means, the second. there is a salah, and two rak'ah salah. And the Sahaba, when they said, they waited and said, Ya Rasulullah, for every it's a wajib, obligatory, in other narration, said, Liman sha, for whoever wants, whoever wills. So there's a sunnah to pray two rak'ah in between the adhan and the iqamah. And Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu قال كان المؤذن إذا قام ناس من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يبتدرون السواري حتى يخرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهم كذلك يصلون ركعتين قبل المغرب ولم يكن بين الأذان والإقامة شيء. Even before Maghrib, even before Maghrib, because before Maghrib you don't have sunnahs like sunnah that you have before Fajr or you have before Dhuhr. But the Sahaba, they used to pray, they used to go behind the pillars of the masjid. Why they go behind the pillars of the masjid? Because they know the word of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to pray, and you have something in front of you that's called sutra. That's why I used to go behind the pillars of the masjid to pray two rak'ah before Maghrib, according to Maghrib time. And they used to pray until the time of the Iqamah of the Maghrib comes. So that was just a little time in between, as he said in the narration, لَمْ يَكُنْ بَيْنَهُمَا إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. Just a little time between the adhan and the iqamah of the maghrib. Another hadith, اِجْعَلْ بَيْنَ أَذَانِكَ وَإِقَامَتِكَ نَفَسًا قَدْرَ مَا يَقْضِي الْمُعْتَصِرْ حَاجَتَهُ فِي مُهَلْ وَقَدْرَ مَا يَفْرُغُ الْآكِلُ مِنْ طَعَامِهِ فِي مُهَلْ. Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said that make between the adhan and the iqamah just little time, that's to breathe, meaning that that time that a person who needs to go to the bathroom, to use the bathroom, let him do whatever he can, let him use it, relieve himself. Or the person who is eating, let him finish the eating, so he needs to pray. So this time it is between the adhan and the iqamah. And there, in this time you can pray salah. هل يجوز الكلام بين الإقامة والصلاة؟ Is it allowed to talk between the إقامة and الصلاة؟ Yes, it's allowed. عن أنس رضي الله عنه قال أقيمت صلاة العشاء فقال رجل لي حاجة فقام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يناجيه حتى نام القوم أو بعض القوم ثم صلوا. So the إقامة, now where is the time between the إقامة and the صلاة? Short time that we said. So one, Anas radiallahu anhu says, this hadith is in hadith Sahih Muslim. He said, the iqam was made in for Salat al-Isha, and a person, he asked the Prophet, he said, I have a problem, I have something. Imagine now, and they talk. People, they're gonna say, Aqim al-Salat al-Shaykh, Salat, then what's happened? And I said to the Prophet, I have something, Ya Rasulullah. Now, could you wait after Salat? No, the Prophet ﷺ talked to him. And then, he didn't talk only 1 minute or 2 minutes. The Sahabi said, حَتَّى نَامَ الْقَوْمُ. Yeah, the people that were, after Isha, because the Sahabi, they used to sleep early. They were during the day and working and things. And they used to sleep early, especially after Salat al-Maghrib, right? Salat al-Isha, right? After Salat al-Maghrib, used to sleep. So, he said, some of the Sahaba, they slept. So the Prophet was talking to that man, that means it took some time. It didn't take like 1 minute or 2 minutes. It took some of the Sahaba said that Naam al-Qawm, or some of them, then they prayed. So it took time. That means that here it is allowed to talk between the Iqamah and the Salah if you have something or that. That doesn't mean that always you have something, you just wait for the time when the Imam is starting the Salah and say, Imam, I have something tell you when the people are waiting there. I'm not going to wait. Al-Adhan and the Dukhul al-Waqt. For sure, the Adhan is not allowed to be done before the time. When the time has entered, then the Adhan should be done. Okay, is it allowed to make the Iqamah another person who did the Adhan? Yes, it is allowed. That another person does the iqamah and not the person who did the adhan. The hadith that is man adhana fahuwa yuqeem, there's a hadith narrated, but this hadith da'eef, that's a weak hadith. Whoever calls adhan, he should call the iqamah. That's a hadith, a weak hadith. So it is allowed to be called or to make the iqama another person who did the adhan. The sunnah of the Prophet for the adhan, for the iqama, actually is to be done not in the same place that the adhan was done. Usually before, they used to call the adhan for a long time ago, no microphones, I think. They used to, but then in the Minara, for example, or high place, masjid and things. So the adhan should be called inside the masjid. Nowadays we call it both inside the masjid because you have the mics. But the sunnah is to be called in, not in the same place. At least you move a little bit from that place. So for example, when I was in Jordan, they used to call the adhan at the microphone and the iqama at the saf, the line in the air. So somebody can say, oh, the people outside. But actually, the adhan has done its job. The adhan is for the people to come to the salah. The iqama, whoever has come, has come. He is inside the masjid. Yani whoever has come around or waiting just for the moment of the iqama. So that's to be done. So you can do it like in this line or close to that, but you can call it a microphone. It's okay even if you call it a microphone. But should be, or is it better to be done in another place, not the same place that was called that adhan? I think we don't have too much time. We have 10 minutes. So we'll call that adhan, inshallah, to put in practice what we were talking about. And then the sunnah, yes. Not too much time. It's not you have to, you can delay it, you can delay it. But it's better to call it a proper time. But tonight you forgot, really, I forgot. Yeah, we're talking about adhan. Nobody taught us, or it's halal to say to the sheikh, time for adhan, sheikh.
We can pray late, no problem.
No, they call. We'll come, inshallah, praying late. Oh, for Salat al-Isha, yes, because we passed that. For Salat al-Isha, just to finish it. For Salat al-Isha, it's a sunnah to pray it, not on the beginning of the time, to pray it late. That's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's better to pray it late because it's the time coming, the time, or the later the best. But if you you see the people, they have to go and we're gonna pray Jama'ah, and you all they decide to pray in that time, it's the beginning of the time, it's good. But if all the people they want to pray late, you can delay it. Or you by yourself, for example, it happened that you were not in the masjid, it's better to delay it. It's called or salat late. Or so, yes, last thing.
Can you talk during the azan as that you predict is mustahab, is not sunnah, so people can talk during the azan or the iqama time?
No, it's not haram, but leave the talk for the other time, but it's not haram, because you cannot consider it, we said for wudu, true. So, because in this time you are supposed, if you want to get the reward, to repeat the word of the adhan, and not only just repeat it like a parent. And you repeat it and really understand it, and live with this, those words that you are saying, in order to get the reward, is Jannah. Allah has samawat wa al-ard. It's not easy. Yeah, so just don't talk like that.
When you call the adhan using the mic, do you still turn your face?
Yes. Still turn your face. Just the mic will move on. Yeah, take your voice. Just a little bit less, but you turn the face. Yes, that's right. SubhanAllah.